In colonial days, this cinema was called the Grand. It's now the Da Guang Ming. It has a prime location on Nanking Road, the city's main shopping thoroughfare, and it's the largest cinema in urban Shanghai, with around 2,000 seats. It opens for business at 8:30 every morning and plays up to 6 shows a day. Virtually every performance sells out 1 or 2 days in advance. Tickets cost 25 or 30 fun. That's 8 to 10 pence. Something like 80 million people a week go to the movies in China, and most of the films they see are Chinese. The economy has made fairly rapid progress since the overthrow of the Gang of Four, but China cannot yet afford to import many foreign films. The country now produces over 100 features a year. You can buy books that purport to be histories of world cinema, but which don't so much as mention Chinese film. That's partly down to the ignorance and laziness of our supposed film scholars, but it also reflects the fact that it's only quite recently that China itself has made any attempt to market its films abroad. And what's become clear in these last few years is that China has both a very rich film heritage and one of the few film industries in the world that still attracts a huge mass audience today. No visitor could miss the prominence of cinema in Chinese life. Television is still in its infancy here, and film remains the mass medium. The magazine stands are full of movie publications, and the majority of street hoardings are posters for new and forthcoming films. The fact is that film has been inextricably involved with all the political and social changes that China has seen, from the struggle for a united country in the 20s and 30s to the civil war of the late 40s and the ideological struggles within the communist government since 1949. Even in the 20s, Shanghai was China's most populous city. It was also the birthplace of Chinese cinema. Literally hundreds of entrepreneurs chanced their arms as film producers here in the 20s and 30s. And it was here that the major companies of the 30s and 40s based themselves. The popularity of cinema made the film industry a prime target for infiltration by the left. A number of vintage picture palaces survived the Japanese bombing to stand as witnesses to those pioneering years, and they're still packed every day. Other cinemas are much newer, like this one, which specializes in 3D movies and offers its audiences a Peking duck in their laps. For this documentary, we wanted to begin exploring the vast history of Chinese cinema, still so little known in the West, as well as looking at the present situation in the film industry. Our base was the Shanghai Film Studio, one of the centers of the industry since the founding of the People's Republic. We began by talking with Sun Yu, who was one of the first leftist intellectuals to enter the industry. He was also the only Chinese director of the 30s who'd been abroad to study film technique.
我在美国大学毕业以后 选这个电影编剧，做电影编剧，调研，这是个选口，这是也修了一年。我回到中国来的时候，这个这是二十，1927年，这个时候中国的电影呢，真正中国电影事业真正很低潮的时候，营业很不好。
Some Chinese movies in 1927 were direct imitations of Western imports. Others, like this version of the perennial Chinese favorite Tale of the Western Chamber, derived from the stage traditions of the Chinese opera. Just around the corner was the first wave of Chinese martial arts films, which became so popular that the Kuomintang government banned them in 1931, afraid that they might incite popular revolt. Sun Yu's early films were melodramas with a strong undertow of realism, highly committed to working people, their lives, their work, their dreams, and their sexuality. By international standards of the period, these films were astonishingly fresh and innovative. Sun's most popular film was The Highway, in which a crew of patriotic road builders give their lives to defend China against invaders. By not naming the Japanese, Sun was skillfully evading Kuomintang censorship.
中国的这个注入的工人呢，生活很苦，但是他们呢很团结。这个时候，日本已经侵略，在侵略中国了，有这个企图了，所以我想拍一个反帝的片子，我就用这个这批注入工人呢，五六个人一道起来团结友爱，来一起来对付这个。
The son of a dock worker came to Lianhua Film Company a little later than Sun Yu, in 1933. He first edited the company's publicity magazine, but soon began directing.
啊，宋慧杰老师，我看到我看到我看到，向你学习啊！我很希望看电影，所以呢，我就希望得到这样的职业。以后我就进了莲花公司了，它是拍这个有声片呢，比较晚。那么在它之前呢，有其他的公司呢，已经开始拍这个有声电影了。
开始的时候，有的公司用蜡盘，然后嘛，他就用录音这种方式来拍摄了。These buildings were part of Lianhua Film Company's offices in the early 30s. They're now part of the Shanghai Film Studio Complex, although they're due for demolition. We were shown around them by another of the pioneers who worked here in the 30s, the cinematographer Huang Xiaofen, now head of the studio's technical department. Huang Xiaofen photographed Song of China for the company in 1935. This scene, a wedding feast in the late Qing dynasty, comes from the start of the film, which goes on to span three generations in a family and ends in the present. The Japanese took Shanghai in 1937, and most of the city's best filmmakers fled to join the resistance. The progressive current in Chinese cinema didn't reappear until 10 years later, initially in Manchuria, one of the first areas liberated from the Japanese. Along the Sungari River was an attempt to exorcise the traumas of the Japanese occupation. It starred the young actress Zhang Ruifang.
抗战的胜利以后，也破坏得很厉害的。我们去了以后，在条件非常困难底下拍的这个戏。当时就只有一个摄影机，就一个摄影机。录音设备也没有。后来拿些个螺丝，就是装配起来的，拍了这个戏非常难，并且当时。 旧中国胶片都是要从国外进口了，那时候已经也没有来源，所以有时候要到香港去搞一点电影片子来，所以拍的还很费劲儿的，可是我们那个拍这个戏的时候是很心情很激动。
40年代，我写的戏呢，那时候的历史事件呢，就是抗日战争胜利了，抗日战争胜利了。但是呢，在当时呢，是由于那个时候的政府，他还是在中国挑起了内战。
Shen Fu and other leftist filmmakers regrouped in Shanghai after the war, under the seemingly neutral banner of the Kunlun Film Company, or the Peak Film Industries Corporation. The civil war between the communists and the Kuomintang was raging, and the Kunlun group became expert in negotiating, or bribing, their way through Kuomintang censorship. Lights of 10,000 Homes was Shen Fu's first social realist production. It opens with this idyllic picture of middle